Hello and welcome to the fourth office hours. We've had a lot of really good discussion in the forums and some great questions. Let's start with a question from MyTool. He asked, in the last office hours, you mentioned something about the possibility of a project at the end of the class. What are your thoughts on us building or the students building a robotic car?
So I just recorded the final class and I actually spent some time programming, putting everything together into a simulation of a car. I mean, at the level of even operating, not a real car. And honestly, it took me a whole day to put the software together. So it's substantial work because at the surface, like these pieces fit together nicely, but when you put them together, you realize that what the planner generates isn't quite exactly what the controller really wants. And tuning those parameters was actually a challenge. But what I've done is, for the final class, I'm giving you the environment first and say, solve the problem of finding driving a car from A to B. And if you're really so inclined, you can go out and retry it. But as the class goes on, I give you most of my implementation, leaving bits and pieces out, and then you can go and plug those bits and pieces in and hopefully make it work.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Unfortunately, I can't really get you a real car. That's the real fun thing. And as you'll see in the final example, the methods that we discussed are the core methods, and they give you a good path, but they don't give you a path good enough for actual driving. So there's a lot of work that goes beyond this class that could be done to make things smoother and more elegant.
Perfect. Tangled asked, in the Unit 414 video, you mentioned something about other cars honking, and he wants to know if Junior can hear. Does he have a microphone sensor that affects its actions, and can he honk himself?
So none of our cars hear, and none of our cars honk. And I know it's certain parts of the world that's kind of a recipe for not driving confidently, safely in traffic, but we chose not to make audio communication part of that experiment.
And then George Bendero asked, while it's possible to constantly replan if enough computational power is available, A-Star assumes a static and deterministic world. So can you comment on some of the possible pitfalls of using A-Star, and what are some of the alternatives to this algorithm?
So that's a great and really deep questions to which I've dedicated a number of research years, turns out, and I've graduated a number of PhD students on that very topic. So A-Star gives you a taste of how cool planning can be, but there's many, many open problems. So for example, A-Star cannot deal with branching outcomes where you flip a coin and you have to pursue both outcomes. It just doesn't work. And it cannot deal with information gathering. Sometimes in planning, what you want to do is you want to take a specific action just for the sake of reducing uncertainty. So for example, I'm going to a grocery store and I don't know whether I have money with me, I might just check, do I have my money here? And this checking action has no other bearing than informing me that my money is in my pocket. That is completely not doable with A-Star right now. The dynamic programming stuff that I discussed has that flavor, so you can actually pursue multiple outcomes and bring them together. It is computationally very inefficient, so you have to basically go the entire state space. And the fact that we build the universal plans is just a side effect of pursuing every possible combination. So the moment the state space gets very large, dynamic programming doesn't scale, and it's a big open issue. Now, if you go to something like Google Maps, what you'll find is that you can do instant path planning between two points. Mm-hmm. And what Google has been doing is pre-caching a lot of the sub-plans, principal sub-plans, so the remaining planning problem of finding the shortest path becomes mostly a table lookup. And they've done this in a way that's actually optimal. They can prove it's optimal for path planning. It's really an amazing achievement that's way beyond A-Star. So the planning field is much more interesting than the lecture alluded. I just want to get your juices flowing to have you use one. Now, we did use A-Star in our world, and the way we addressed replanning in the car environment is that we just planned really, really fast. So we had a version of A-Star that was super fast, and we saw something new, we just replan, and that was just fine for us.
Okay. So you mentioned something about dynamic programming just now, and the user AJAP had a very good question about that. How large is the planning policy for Junior?
So in Junior's case and the Google self-driving car cases, we don't do that much planning. We basically plan only within the visual horizon of the vehicle itself. So we don't address the problem how to get from here to Paris, what streets to take. We assume that's solved by Google Maps, so we assume a fixed route in all our driving. But once the fixed route is kind of specced out, all the planning that takes place is within the visual range of the robot. And they're typically three-dimensional state spaces. They're typically X, Y, and orientation. Now, in some of our experiments, we also use velocity as a state variable, because sometimes you want to take a little detour so you can go straight and be faster. Mm-hmm. But they're relatively low-dimensional spaces.
Okay. Another question from George Brindero was about prohibitively expensive left turns. So are the costs of actions, are these a dynamic variable that's constantly being updated, or are they static within the car?
So the way we've handled the cost of action is we have a version that looks at the global picture, like for go from A to B and find the costs there. And then zooming back to the local picture, in the local picture, we're able to actually consider cars right now at this moment, whereas in the global picture, we assume a static world and we make a fixed cost for left turns. Now, as we go to the local picture, we do a lot of local rollouts, local look-ahead plans, not dissimilar from A-Star, and then fill in the actual costs of left turns and replace them with the assumed cost. And that sometimes leads to different actions. So we have situations where we are planning to do a lane shift, but we can't because it's just too expensive right now, and we rather endure being stuck behind a slower car until the lane shift is cleared. Okay. So there's an interplay of two levels of planning going on.
Deepal wanted to know about multi-goal environments, and an obvious example in a multi-goal environment would be a parking lot. I want to get to an empty parking spot.
So that's a great question I should have asked you with the students, because it has a really nice and obvious answer, which is, here's the answer. In A-Star, you can certainly designate multiple states to be goal states. Nothing prohibits this. You just have to make sure your heuristic is admissible, so it takes a value that is underestimating or at least estimating correctly the distance to any of those goal states, and then it's just fine. The same is true for dynamic programming. You can certainly have multiple goal states there. Nothing in the formulation is a problem here.
So talking about heuristic functions, Drew Noakes had a question, and I think a lot of people are wondering, since this is really where A-Star gets its speed, is in the choice of the heuristic function. Are they deduced algorithmically, or are they just done with intuition, trial and error? How do we decide?
That's a fantastic question. There's actually a really deep question as well. In the car domain, we actually calculate heuristic functions. And we have two heuristic functions we kind of superimpose. And both of them get at the gist of the planning problem, but they're much easier to compute. So suppose you have an environment with obstacles, and your planning space is three-dimensional, like your X, your Y, and your orientation. One way to do heuristic is to ignore the rotational degree of freedom and assume you're moving a disk in any direction. And obviously moving a robot in any direction is easier than being constrained by the physics of the car. So this becomes now a two-dimensional problem. And by going from three dimensions to two dimensions, we can solve the entire problem in no time. So we plan in 2D and use the 2D planning result as a heuristic for the 3D planner. And the reason why it works is because 2D planning is so much faster than 3D planning. That's one. The second, so this is basically ignoring the physical constraints of the car and going to a simpler car model, which is it can move in any direction anytime. The second heuristic we're using looks at the 3D problem, but without obstacles. So we can pre-plan the optimal action of a 3D robot that has turning constraints in a 3D space, X, Y, and orientation, to any goal location in advance. We do this once and it's true forever. Without any obstacles. And what this gets us is that sometimes to get into a certain target orientation, you have to take a certain turn. And that turn has to be taken no matter what, and obstacles will only make it worse. So if you compute this obstacle-free heuristic, you sort of get an underestimate that gets only worse with obstacles, so you have an admissible heuristic. We toss both of these heuristics in as heuristics in A-Star, and we get a speed-up of our planner easily of a factor of 10 to 100 in practice.
That's very interesting. Great.
So it's actually, I'm giving these examples, I don't want you to re-implement those right now, but that shows you how deep this question really is. If you can come up with good ways of cheating and solving the problem by relaxing a constraint, do it much faster, that tends to be a great heuristic for A-Star.
All right, well, thanks a lot. We had a lot of great questions. I'm sure we'll have a lot next week. Can you give us a little preview of what's coming in units 5 and 6?
Yes, so first of all, I want to thank you for this question. I really appreciate how deep they are and how much you connect with the material. I think that's great. I mean, I honestly, personally, I much prefer them over questions as, like, when can I buy my next self-driving car? I think this is really deep material I'm trying to teach you, and I love the fact that many of you are diving in and really deeply, because that's what I want to enable you to do, to apply it in a deep way. So keep these questions coming. In section unit 5 and 6, I'll dive into control. Control is now the art of turning these abstract, like discrete and chunky paths into actual steering motion. It's a continuous thing because your steering is continuous and time is continuous. So we're going to go away from the discrete world into the continuous world. And in unit 6, I try to toss everything together. So in unit 6, we program, hopefully, an entire robotic car with my help, where we go all the way to localization at the same time and path planning at the same time and control, and hopefully generate some actual driven trajectories by our simulated car.
All right. I can't wait. I'm sure the students feel the same way. And thanks a lot.
And see you in class.